Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. Thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives. Tonight, Lord, we haven't come to hear from a man or a woman. We haven't come to hear from a white man or black man or brown man or tall man, short man, old man, young man. We don't do that here at The Rock. We come to hear from you, who is the teacher, the Holy Spirit. Welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in this house this night. And God will give you the praise. Bless all the churches that are meeting, all our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis. Thank you, God, for the Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist. We thank you, God, for all these great churches that are out there, our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters. Bless them, Lord, as you would bless us, and we'll give you the praise, the glory, and all the honor. We're all in agreement with a great big shout. We say amen. Well, I want you to do something with me tonight. I want to share with you something that's been on my heart for a long time. And I realize it's God, and he wants me to share it with you. Sometimes God deals with me about things. And we've been in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, talking about Abraham, you know, on the weekend, and Sarah and the great faith that they had, people of great faith. And there were some things that just jumped out at me about Abraham and things that jumped out at me about, if you will, Sarah. And I just wanted to share them with you because I really believe it's important for you and I also to understand the Word of God in such a way. Tonight, if you're making a note and you're taking notes, the title of this message is Developing Spiritual Strength. All of us are believing God for something. If you're not, then you need to get in there and start believing God. I mean, how'd you become a Christian if you aren't even believing God for heaven, eternal life? You're believing God for something. Some of you are believing God for your business, and some of you are believing God for your education. Some of you are believing God to pay some of those bills that have been mounting up, and you never have any idea how you're going to get through them, just financial problems all the time. Some of you are believing God for family. Some of you are believing God for your children. Some of you are believing God for, you know, all the things that maybe relatives that are mistreated you or relatives that are going in the wrong direction. Some of you are just believing God so that you can fit in life, feel comfortable about things and not live a life of just get by, but live a life more productive. God wants to take you, and I've often said this many times, God wants to take you to your own personal promised land, like he took the children of Israel when they took them out of bondage. They've been in bondage for 400 years, and they was going to bring them through the wilderness, but he was going to take them to a place filled with milk and honey, and he does, and he does just that, and they refused to go in to their own promised land because they felt they were not strong enough to do it. Now, I'm going to tell you, if you're believing God for something, you're going to have to remain strong. I want to make a statement that's kind of funny. I want you to hear it. The statement is simple for all of us that are believing God for something. Having strength is not the same as receiving strength. Let me make that statement again to you, and then I'll give you a couple of verses to explain it to you. Having strength. I need strength to believe God for my business. I need strength to believe God to stand up in front of you. I need strength to properly evaluate the Word of God and be able to communicate it so that you can get it. I mean, it's no good if I talk and you don't understand it. It's no good if you hear something but you can't apply it. I've got to be able to get into your heart. I need the strength to do that. Maybe you're believing for a marriage or the children, like I say, maybe a husband or wife that's out of sync with you, and you're just standing believing God for something in life. You're not even quite sure. Maybe you've never even bought a house. You're believing for your first house or believing that you'll have a better place to live or a better education or a better job or maybe even a better boss or maybe you becoming the boss. Whatever it is that you're believing God for, You're never going to have it if you don't have the strength to get into your own personal promised land, that place where you're believing God for something. Oftentimes, we misunderstand strength. Strength is a funny word. We see strength like the, you know, the heroes that are in movies, the ones that have big muscles, or, you know, the one that have all the talent and all the giftings and all the abilities, those people are strong. And, you know, a man can be strong in his own strength and never have the strength in order to accomplish what God has for them. And until you receive the strength, it's not about the strength that you have, it's about the strength that God gives you. And it's mixed with the strength that you have that causes you to be not natural in what you're believing God for, but the supernatural part of believing God. And oftentimes we misunderstand having strength. And you know, have you ever felt weak in your faith? You ever felt like you just, you don't deserve it? You don't feel like you're going in the right direction. You don't feel like something's happening. And you just feel simply weak in your faith. And did you know that sometimes, I want to share this with you and I'll prove it tonight, that that's some of the best times to receive the strength that you need is when you are weak in your own abilities. And tonight I want to talk about that. I'd like to solidify simply how to develop this spiritual strength. And we could talk about how to develop muscles. We could talk about how to develop physically. We could talk about how to develop mentally. But I want to talk about how to develop spiritually so you can enter into the promised land, that promise that God's given you for whatever it is that you're believing God for. A couple of things that just set me off that I thought were very, very interesting. Talking about Abraham in Romans, the 4th chapter. We're going to look at a lot of verses. So you're going to have to go with me kind of quick. So is that okay that we do that? In Romans, the 4th chapter, talking about Abraham. How great is Abraham? I mean, here's this guy. He doesn't have a Bible. He doesn't have, years of family experience. He's the first Hebrew there ever was. You say, you mean the first Jew? No, Judah wasn't even developed in those days. He was the first Hebrew believer. God spoke to him. The guy was a moon worshiper. And all of a sudden, the real God speaks to him, and he goes, wow, I heard that. It's God. I'm going to do it. Everybody in his family, everybody in his relatives, everybody just told him, you're crazy. Why would you want to do something? That you following a voice that you don't even know? He said, but there was something on the inside of him, and he lives this amazing life, and of course, he's in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, but also Romans, the 4th chapter, talks about him. There's an interesting thing that is said in Romans, the 4th chapter, if you'll look at it with me in verse number 19, talking about Abraham, and it says, and not being weak in faith. If he's not weak in faith, he has to be some other way. If he's not weak, he's got to be strong. Let me try that again, see if you get it. If he's not weak, he's got to be something different. What would that be? Strong. So God makes it very clear that he's not weak in strength, but he's very strong. He says he did not consider his own body. Now, let's read it again. Already dead. Remember, he is 90 years old, and God speaks to him about having a child. Remember, we talked about it many times, kind of a funny little story. If I was 90 years old, I'm 70 years old. So if I was 90 years old, and God said, you're having a child, I'd kill myself. And, so that in itself is a lot of faith. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, if Debbie came up to me and said, God spoke to me last night, and I'm pregnant, I'd say, that's it, I'm out of here. But here he is, 90 years old. And the Bible says this, that he didn't consider himself, his own body, already dead since he was about 100 years old. And the deadness of Sarah's, well, she was past that. She was dead too. And trust me, when you get in those older ages and those older years, things aren't like what they were when they were young. I mean, when you're young, you're hot. When you're old, it's just nice to be warm. And so, you see what I'm saying? You know, some of you laugh because you know what I'm talking about. You're getting there, aren't you? And so, and verse number 20 says this word. It's kind of fun. And it says this, he did not waver at the promise of God. So many of us get something from God, we start immediately questioning it. Well, what if? What if? Well, I'm not sure. That doesn't fit me. I certainly could never do that. Well, that's just not part of who I am. I couldn't live up to those expectations. I can't do that. I'm not smart enough, or I'm not talented enough. And you start wavering. You start talking yourself out of this. Wavering means something is flipping back and forth. It's what it really says. One minute you're in, next minute you're out. Has anybody ever been there in your faith? You're believing God for something. One minute you're in, one minute you're out. You're not sure. One minute you're up and powerful. Next minute you're down and out. And yeah, it's just crazy. He says, but listen to these words. He did not waver at the promise of God. So every one of us have promise that you're believing God for. Hopefully you're believing God for something. You got a promise. God spoke something in your heart that you can believe God for him and do it. He's a restoration God. He's a God of restoration. He's a God that heals marriages and heals bodies. Maybe you're sick in your body and you just know that God wants to heal you and not have those pains, not have that sickness anymore. May I say this to you? That's exactly the way it is. That's a promise from God. The word of God, then you find the word of God that says that he's healed you by his stripes, and all of a sudden you got word backing up the promise. And all of a sudden it doesn't happen when you think it happens, so you start wavering. You start going back and forth. The Bible says in James, first chapter, that a man who is double-minded does what? Don't let him think he's going to get anything. Same as wavering. Double-minded means, oh, I'm in it one moment, I'm out of it next moment. Boy, you know, I go to church and I get all pumped up, but then Monday reality comes and I don't know whether or not it's really God that spoke to me. I don't know if I could do that. I don't know. And then we start wavering on these promises. And he says he didn't waver through God's promises with unbelief. Now watch these words. But was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. Now, can I just say something? I see the word faith, and it's really about faith. And giving glory to God, we understand what that means. Man, he's praising God for the goodness of God that's in his life. He hasn't seen it yet. He hasn't had the child yet. Sarah's not having a baby yet. She's not even like Erica, pregnant yet. None of that stuff. But it didn't matter. When God spoke it, it was settled. It isn't settled when you see it, because then you don't have to have faith. Then you know. But you need to know it when it's spoken. Is anybody listening? And so when God spoke it, he rejoiced in that. That was his faith. But notice this, but was strengthened. And that word strengthened just jumped out at me. Because there's things I'm believing God for. I'm thinking, God, what am I believing God for that for? I don't have to do that. I don't need to do that anymore. I'm past all of that. I can't stand the idea of that, but there's something on the inside just like churning. It's like this promise that I've got from God, and a man my age shouldn't be doing those things and shouldn't be active in those areas, and there's just something rolling around on the inside of me, and in order for it to come to pass, there's something that has to happen. I need strengthening, because my faith is always weaker than I think it ought to be. That's Abraham. I thought it was real interesting about Sarah, because she's the one that's going to carry this child. You know, she's like 90 years old. And let's take a look at that, if you will. Go with me to Hebrews in the 11th chapter. And you know where that's at. It ought to fall open on your Bible by now if you're coming to this church. And we've been there for a couple of years. And it says this in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. And it says, by faith, Sarah herself. And then the next two words, also received, and then that third word, strength. So God spoke something to them, and then God, or somehow, they received strength. Here's Sarah. She received strength. Here's Abraham. He received strength. And for a lot of us that are in here, in order for those promises that God spoke to us, we're going to have to, in order to go through all the time of the wilderness before the promise comes to pass, we're going to need to be strengthened. And it's so important for us to see that, because without it, man, then we get back to it. Now, I oftentimes, I don't know if you're like me, but I oftentimes find myself finding my strength in my own ability. And that's why I said having strength is different than receiving strength. My own ability can only take me so far. But when I get the ability of God that piggybacks my ability, what's the limit? The limit is what I can believe God for. That's what's being said here with the life of Abraham and the life of Sarah. Very important for us. Believing God is one thing. Staying strong until it manifests itself is another. Last time we were together, we talked about, if you remember, in Isaiah 40th chapter, verse number 31, he that waits upon the Lord shall renew his strength. And we talked about a waiting period that last time I taught at the church. We talked about the waiting period. So tonight, I want to share just two little thoughts for you about developing, if you will, very important, our spiritual strength. Very important for us, developing our spiritual strength. Number one, here's something that you need to always remember. Very important for us is this. The source of spiritual strength is not you, but it's God. And you gotta keep that in mind, because at times you're gonna think, I'm weak, I'm down, I'm out, I'm not there, I'm questioning, I'm wavering, I'm questioning on whether or not it's gonna come to pass. I'm having a difficult situation and people are talking me out of it and I don't feel strong about it. And you've got to remember that the source is very important. The source is God. And I know that sounds silly, but a lot of us that are humans look to every other source but God for our strength. I've seen people rejoice because they get lots of money. Money doesn't make you rejoice. It's God that makes you rejoice. And when you rejoice in God, he gets you the money. And someone rejoiced because they got a new job. But the new job doesn't make you rejoice. The rejoicing has got to come because you were strengthened by the presence of God. God got you the job. So the praise doesn't go with the fact that you've got this new job or new position that brought in new income to buy a house. Now you're rejoicing over the house, because it won't be long for the house needs a paint job. Won't be long for the roof falls apart. But God remains the same always. So as long as our minds and our hearts are constantly fixed on him, then he becomes the source of our strength. My strength doesn't come because I have the ability to do it. My strength doesn't come because I'm happy. My strength doesn't come because I can now do something. My strength doesn't come because I can now function in something. My strength doesn't come because I now have something. My strength comes from God. And when my strength comes from God, I find that God strengthens me more. And that's what I need during troubled times. It's so important for, if you will, in Daniel, the 11th chapter. Let's play a little bit in the Old Testament, and then we'll come back into the New Testament with that thought in mind about God being your source of spiritual strength. If you will, go with me to Daniel in the 11th chapter. In Daniel, there's this really cool thing. The writings of Daniel are just so impressive and so full of power and truth it's just amazing all the things that are there with the book of Daniel. Let me try to find it here, and I'm going every direction talking to you, and I'm not finding the book of Daniel. Where are you, Daniel? Here you are in the 11th chapter, and it says these words. That gives you time to find it too. In verse number, I love this, 11th chapter, in verse number 32, just the last part of this verse, which is so cool. The last part says this: but the people who know their God, but the people who know their God, but the people who know how to do it, the people who have the education, the people that have the resources, the people that have the money backing, the people who have the people behind them cheering them on. See, in order to be strong, it's people who simply know where strength comes from. And that what you need to carry you through that day comes from God. Every day you're going to have to tap into him. Sometimes every hour. Sometimes, does anybody know what I'm talking about? Every half an hour. Sometimes every minute. If you're plagued with pain, you're going to be there every minute. You're going to be praising God. And it says, the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. But here's the deal. They're going to also see the promises of God fulfilled in their life. Very important. While you're there in Isaiah, take a look at Isaiah 41. And this time, we looked at 40 last week. But let's take a look at Isaiah, the 41st chapter. And it says this in verse number 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. Watch this. In other words, I'm thinking all the time, I'm alone. I don't know how to do this. I can't make it. I don't know how we're going to pay those bills. We owe too much. We'll never get out of debt. We'll never own a house. We'll never be happy. We'll never be able to put our kids through school. We'll never be able to do all these things. And we stop and we fail about the very source of the strength that we need in order to carry us through that rough time into the blessings and the promises of God. And he says, be not dismayed. You know, that's where you start to waver. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? That's where discouragement sets in, and all of a sudden, you start to say to yourself, I'm a double-minded man. Yesterday, I was pumped up. Today, I'm not pumped up so much. And he says, don't be dismayed, for I am your God. He didn't say, I'm just your friend. I'm the God who created the heavens and the earth. I'm the God that speaks and planets exist. Hello. I'm the God that holds the moon at its right distance so the land isn't flooded by the waters. I'm the God that holds it at its right axis. I'm the God that keeps the sun away so we don't burn or the too far away so we don't, freeze. I'm the God that holds it all together. Let me tell you something. Someone asked me the other day, in fact, it was yesterday. Someone said, you believe in global warming, don't you? And I knew that they were an ecology person, and I didn't want to get into anything with them. So I said, yes, I do believe in global warming, even though I really don't believe that type of global warming. But I do believe this type of global warming. Hold on, it's all going to burn. So I believe it because God said it. It's like somebody asking you, oh my goodness, do you believe in the Big Bang Theory? Absolutely. God spoke and bang, it existed. I mean, I don't care I just believe that stuff. You know what I'm saying? And I don't care, but here he comes along, he says, I am God. Sometimes we read that, we really don't get a sense of what he's saying. Listen, he didn't say I'm an army. He didn't say I'm Security Pacific. Thank God they're out of business. He didn't say I'm Washington Mutual. Thank God. Someone says you can go to the bank. Please don't go to the bank on anything. They're not trustworthy at all. You want to go somewhere, go with God. So when God makes his statement, he says, I am just not a God. I'm your God. Hello. Like, come on. You know, it's not just a God. I'm your God. You know, isn't it neat when he identifies with us? I mean, can you imagine how important you must be that he would send his son down, his only begotten son, to be beaten, bloody, take the iniquities of sin of the whole entire planet on his shoulders, go to the cross and die for you, raised from the third day. Who in the heck are you? Let me tell you something. May I ask you something? Who are you that God says, I am your God? Oh my goodness, he's not talking to a frog, he's not talking to Mickey Mouse, he's not talking to Donald Duck, he's talking to you and you and you and you. You're not alone tonight, you got God on your side. Wow, I mean that's like amazing. And then he comes along after he says, I am your God, he says, I might someday, if you're really cool, you know, be someone who strengthen you. Doesn't say that at all. He says, that's a promise, by the way. When you're down, out, discouraged, double-minded, flipping around, and you're wondering, is this, you know, we're funny humans. They can do something, God will do something great one day. 3 days later, we forgot. Is anybody like me? I mean, you forgot. You say, okay, God, I need another sign. I need another miracle. You know, I bet we just tickle God. I'd wipe you all out. But it's God. You know, God is so cool. He's not bothered by that stuff. He knows humanity that forgets all the time. And he says these words, I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Kind of neat if you really stop and think about that. Let's go to the New Testament just for a second. We've been playing around the Old Testament a little bit. We're talking about strengthening. We're talking about a very important strengthening that we get spiritually and how to not just have it, but to develop it and receive it every day. Number one, you got to realize the source is God. Very important for us. Ephesians 3rd chapter. Let's just turn there. I don't want to hear what a man has to say, so let's find out what God has to say by looking at Ephesians 3rd chapter, verse number 16. He says, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. I mean, first of all, let's just talk about this verse for a second. Talk about Jesus. Jesus giving you something, okay? And he says, notice the capital H and the word he up there. That he, God, would grant you. In other words, it's called grace. He just gives it to us. This strength is not something that you earn. It's something God gives that you learn how to receive. Let me say that again to you. Strength is not something you earn. Strength is something you receive because God grants it or gives it to you. He says that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. In other words, he's going to give me something, and it's in accordance to the riches of his manifested goodness. In other words, he's not giving you something horrible. He's not giving you something that's going to hurt you. He's going to give you something that's according to his, that word glory means manifested. That means made out in the open, coming up here. Here it is. Glory. This man, his riches that he's going to give you, he says, is going to be according to his manifested goodness, his glory. And then he says in that same breath, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. Let me tell you something, my friends. We go everywhere to be strengthened. We call our aunts and uncles and see if they'll loan us money. We go to the bank and see if we can get our credit card extended. We spend how many years, some of you in school? My friend Dr. Kenga, I don't know if he's here tonight, but Dr. Kenga has 3 medical degrees. How many years in school is that? That's like insane. Like one is bad enough, but 3? You got to be kidding me. It's like, oh my goodness. And so we spend a lot of time learning how to get strength to face the future when strength is something that is received by God because of his grace according to his manifested goodness, and he grants it to us. Oh my goodness sakes alive. He's the source. And that's why number one thing before you ever have a problem and you don't know where you're going or how you're going to solve the problem, the number one thing you and I need to train ourselves to do, and you got to train yourself to do this, is you got to go to God first. Because he's the source. God, I need healing. I'm not going to go to the doctor and then ask for healing. I'm going to the great physician in the sky that goes beyond doctors. He's the healer. We thank God for doctors in this church, or half of us would be dead by now. So they're on the same side as God doing what they know to do. But still, God is still the one we should go to first because he's the source of the strength that we need in order to bring the promise to pass. Has anybody got that? Because he's God that wants to grant you and I according to his rich glory. Whew. Well, I don't know what that means. That means in the likeness of his great glory. So powerful. Second thought for tonight, then we'll close. And this is a good thought. I like this thought. Is that in order for us to develop spiritual strength, we're going to have to know this for sure. Watch this, because this will really help you. Weak position is not a bad position. Let me say it again, and then I'll explain it to you. Are you listening? Weak position is not a bad position. I've lived all my life saying, I've got to be strong. I've got to be strong. I've got to hang in there. I've got to fight this good fight of faith. Sometimes you need to know when you've done all you know how to do, it's in that weakness that you finally receive the strength that you need. And sometimes God will work with us until we get out of ourselves and we know we can't go any further but Him. And He's waiting for us to get out of our strength so He can give us by His glory, His strength. Listen to this. So that we can receive the power that we need, the strength, edification, the building up that we need to hang on until the promise comes. And sometimes, can I just say this? Sometimes, it doesn't mean you lay down and do nothing, but sometimes it's time for you to back off of your own self. You know, you did not get saved, if you're really saved, because of what you did. You had to submit who you were to Him. You couldn't even get saved in your own power. Why do you think you would overcome an obstacle in your own power? You couldn't even get saved in your own strength. You know? So why do you think in your own strength you can overcome the problem? You can't. It's in the place of weakness. Weakness means dependency. Weakness means humility. Weakness means I'm in the back seat, God. You're in the front seat, God. Weakness means it's not about me, God. I've put on all I could put in. I've done all I know how to do. I've prayed. I've stood. I've prayed, but I'm getting weak. And God, I know how to do this. I'll do everything I know how to do. But God, I can't make it happen. Only You can. And sometimes, my friends, we just have to get out of the way so God can get in the way. Remember how Deborah brilliantly said Sarah couldn't have a child until she, remember the verse? Or remember what she said, the comment? Until she couldn't have a child. Till she finally realized, you gotta be kidding, I'm 90 years old, I gotta have a child. My womb is dead. The old man, forget it. Viagra doesn't even help him. And yet, it wasn't Viagra. It was God. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Is this mature enough audience to understand that? And that's the point of this whole thing. Sometimes we're always looking for something else in that strength to get us to where we need to go. And it's in the weakness that God comes through, and He does that because He loves us and He's full of grace for us. And He cares us. And the one thing He's looking for is acknowledgement from us that we can't do it, but He can. So wonderful to understand that real quick. In 1 Corinthians, one of my favorite verses in the world, one of the things that God first talked to me about when I was getting into ministry, who knows, 45 years ago now, and that's long before I was a pastor, and preaching on radio in Santa Barbara, California, in early morning, Deborah heard me preach. And long before I was pastoring. And so it was, I can't do this, God. It's impossible. But I'll tell you what I'll do. I will really try. And I'm expecting You to do the difference. And it worked. Today I stand before you. This church is a wonderful, healthy church. And that's the most important thing about this church. And it's not because of me. It's because of Him. If it was me, we'd still be back in a hotel room meeting with about 40 people that come in and out all the time. Developing spiritual traits. In 1 Corinthians, go with me in the first chapter. One of my classes in Bible colleges is one of the first verses that we go to in Scripture, understanding the condition of the heart and what God's really looking for in the condition of the heart. But 1 Corinthians, first chapter. Verse 27, I'll put it up on the overhead for you. Watch this, it's about you, so listen closely. It says, but God has chosen the foolish things of this world to put to shame the wise. You know, the world thinks it's so wise. Before I came here tonight, here was a whole bunch of guys on a platform all telling why they should be president of the United States. And you know, can I just say something to you? You can talk all you want to talk about. We need this, we need that, we need this, we need that. The bottom line, we need God. And you might as well know it, when America started turning its back on God in the early 60s, taking God out of school, out of prayer, abortion comes in. Now you got the four men in the country making a law about who gets married and can get married and doesn't get married, changing all that kind of stuff, whether you like it or don't like it, whether you've been brainwashed by this world or not. The truth is not what a man says. The truth is what God says. And the verse comes along, which is, you know, really ticks off the world, because we're coming along, we're not saying what we think, we're saying what God thinks. I can't understand it, but that's what God says. And if God says it, that's the way it is. And if God said it, I believe it. My goodness, the God that speaks and planets exist, I want to listen to him more than I want to listen to some politician. Sorry, I'm getting off on that. But the verse says, but God has chosen the foolish things. Did you know what the foolish things are? You. And me. Wait a minute. Someone says, what do you mean, foolish thing? You are so stupid, it's unbelievable. You believe in a God you haven't seen and a God you haven't heard? You've never done it. You got to be out of your mind. That book, you know, is thousands of years old. You're the world sees you as the foolish. Just so happens we know that we know that we know that we know. They don't know that yet. But we know something they don't know. And they see us as foolish, but they see themselves as very wise. God has chosen the foolish things of this world to put to shame the wise. Listen to this. And God has chosen the weak things. You know who the weak things are? You and I. Because we just can't do it without God. Someone said to me, oh, God's a crutch. I said to him immediately, God's not a crutch. He's the entire hospital. You got to be kidding me. And he said, well, that's what I'm talking about. And I said, yeah, but you're going to find out there's no other way. Because my Bible says every knee shall bow. That means yours too, buddy. And they just thought I was foolish and stupid, but I don't care. Guess what? I've lived successful, prosperous. My children are blessed. My home's blessed. My life's blessed. My finances are blessed. My car's blessed. I got a little dog about that big. He's totally blessed. Everybody around me's blessed. I'm telling you, call me foolish, call me anything you want. But I'm telling you, as an old man, I'm standing before you telling you this Bible works. And now watch this. He says, but God has chosen the weak things, that's you and me, of the world. Notice the words of the world. Very important. Of the world, that means the world has a different view, to put to shame the things that are, they think they're so tough and mighty. Really cool. In other words, you and I are weak, but God makes us strong. Amen. I love what it says. Paul's confronted by a problem in his life. The Bible says this problem is, if you really study it out, it's the devil and messenger of Satan. And he has prayed three times for God to remove this problem. Have you ever prayed two, three, four, five times for God to remove a problem? See, and he has got no answer. Can I just make a statement? When Paul the Apostle prays, I don't know, somehow the writer of two-thirds of the New Testament, I kind of think he has a little bit more with God. He prays and doesn't get the answer he wants. Sometimes we pray, don't get the answer we want, we get weak and quit on God. But he makes a statement about praying and not getting the answer he wants. And it's found in 2 Corinthians. You're already in 1 Corinthians. Go with me to the 12th chapter. And he makes this, remember, we're talking about in a weakened position being strong. In 2 Corinthians, in the 12th chapter. And it says these words, as he writes these words. It's really cool. Verse number 9. And he said to me, in other words, he'd made these petitions. These problems have been coming against him and coming against him. God, I want you to remove the problem. And then God says to him, verse number 9, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. That's cool. In other words, you don't have to have the problem removed. My grace will take care of you. A lot of times we need the problem removed, but the problem being removed doesn't strengthen you. What strengthens you is the source from God. My grace is sufficient. But then he makes a statement, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. In other words, God's speaking to him. Notice the capital M's up there, the word my. He says, my God, this is what God said to him, my grace is sufficient. You don't need to get out of the problem. You need to know that God's going to take care of you. Why? Because the source of your future strength and bringing a result to the problem or bringing the promise to come to pass is the simple fact that God is the source. Back to number one. And he says this, he's frustrated, he's saying, God, you know, here I am, I'm doing all this work for you, I've asked you to remove this messenger of Satan who's buffeting me on a constant basis, could you just get rid of it? And God makes a statement to him, he says, my grace is sufficient. In other words, my grace will take care of you. The answer to your prayer is found in my grace. Oh my goodness, how often do we look everywhere else except in the grace of God? But then he makes this brilliant statement, this is God speaking to Paul. He says, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Now, wait a minute. You read that, and some of you might say, is God saying he's strong when he's weak? God's not weak. The weakness he's talking about is you and me. So let's read it that way. He says, my strength, God's strength, which you and I need in order to get through this problem and keep on going in life and bring about the promises and the blessings of the Lord. Oh my goodness, I need his strength because he's the only source of strength that I need. He says, is made perfect in your weakness. Now to confirm that, the very next verse comes along. And the next verse says in verse number 10, therefore, Paul's now writing about himself. He says, I take pleasure in my... One translation translates it like this. Instead of infirmities, because you read that, you think he's talking about sickness. He's not. The real translation, another translation says it like this. I take pleasure in my weakness. I'm not talking about sickness. He's talking about weakness. He says, therefore, I take pleasure in weakness, in a reproach, in needs. Oh my goodness. In persecution. Oh my goodness. In distress. Well, listen, we have all that on us. We're begging God to get out. But Paul had a different evaluation of it. Notice what he says. For Christ's sake. In other words, if I'm getting persecuted, I'm having distress because I'm a Christian. There's reproaches coming against me. I have needs that are not being met. Anybody ever had needs that are not being met? He says, if I'm in that position, then he says this. For when I'm weak, then I am strong. Why? Because back to one, the source is strength received from God that helps you to keep going on until the manifestation of what you're believing God for comes to pass. And we go everywhere else to try to get it, except the source being God. Now, the New Testament, I don't even know if I have it on the overhead or not. If I do, I'll quote it for you. He says in Acts 1:8, do I have that? I do. You shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. You shall be witnesses to me, notice the capital M, in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. In other words, you're going to be a witness. You're not going to be a witness of being a wimp. You're going to be a witness of being strong. But what made you strong, back to number one, was the source that you received from God, strength. See. And he says, you shall receive power. Now, this is where the church breaks down. In Acts, the 9th chapter, which I'm not going to put up on the overhead, I'm just going to tell you about it. They heard Philip preaching. They believed Philip's preaching about Jesus. They believed about Jesus. They went out and got baptized, would you think they're saved? They heard the preaching of the word. They believed Jesus. They went out and got baptized. Saved. And then they find out, but the Holy Ghost hadn't come upon them yet with power. And they go back and pray for them to receive. And that's what he's saying. Put Acts back up there in Acts 1:8. He says, but you shall receive power. Some of you need power. And that power comes from a relationship with God through the Holy Spirit. Don't misunderstand me. When you got saved, you got the Holy Spirit. No doubt about it. But there's something that happens with the Holy Spirit when you get out of your way and you get out of the way. You don't have to figure it out. You don't have to be intellectual. You don't have to say this makes sense. You know, people that say, I only believe what makes sense, you have a problem with the Bible. Because I like to know how you figure out someone walks on water. I haven't made that out yet either. Are blind eyes open? Are people after they've been dead for... How does that work? You're not going to believe that? You only believe the things that make sense? The one relationship we have is we have a miracle-working God. Now, wait a minute. You received the Holy Spirit when you got saved, but some of you haven't got the power of the Holy Spirit that you need in order to get the strength to keep on going until the manifestation of your promise. And the Bible makes it very clear that you need to receive Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit of power. And the Bible says there's a baptism of the Holy Spirit. The word baptism means a submerging. I don't just get the Holy Spirit inside me. Now every being of my body is submerged in him. I don't know how it works. I'm submerged in him. He's submerged in me. It's like being in a swimming pool. I can be up to my waist in a swimming pool, but until I go down under the water and submerged in the Holy Spirit, and you'll find everybody that's ever done anything that stays in power are people who are people of the Holy Spirit. So the strength that you get that is from the source of God in the New Testament comes by the baptism of the submerging of the Spirit of God on the inside, you. Let's get you saved right now. You don't get saved because you think you're saved. You don't get saved because you're good. You didn't get saved because you came to church tonight. You don't get saved because you celebrate Christmas or Easter. You get saved because you are born again. Born again means you've given God, listen to me. Born again means from the beginning of the Bible, the end of the Bible, you have given God all of your heart and all of your life. He's not a thief to rob it from you. It's your heart and life. And my friends, listen to me. Some of you tonight could no more get filled with the Holy Spirit or be baptized in the Holy Spirit to receive that power, that strength that you need to get through the problem that you're facing than the man in the moon, because you're not yet right with God, and you got to get right with God before that happens. And I want to see you tonight literally filled, baptized, submerged in the Holy Spirit of power. And you'll find that in Acts, the second chapter, the Holy Spirit falls on them and they receive their prayer language and they all spoke in tongues. It didn't say some spoke in tongues. They all spoke in tongues. And you'll find that through the whole New Testament. You'll find it all through the book of Acts. It's not something that just happened then. It's something that happens now. If you need strength in your life right now, maybe if, number one, you ought to see, have you given God all of your heart? Have you given God all of your life? You can do that right in your seat tonight. I'll leave you in your seat. You don't have to come up. You don't have to do anything, but you're going to have to make an expression. I want you to pray, and we'll all pray a prayer and get you saved, and then we're going to have a baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you want that, then our pastors will come up, and we're going to pray for you to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But you're going to have to come up leaving yourself behind. It's simple. Because strength comes from the source, and it comes in the midst of weakness, not in your personal abilities. Got to get rid of your personal abilities to get this kind of power. So tonight, here you are. If you need me to pray for you, the Bible says it like this. If you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. You know you haven't given God all of your heart. You haven't given God all of your life. You're living this weak life. You never thought you could ever live up to it. Guess what? You can't, but the power of God and His grace can help you to do that. All you have to do is raise your hand, and I'll pray with you tonight. And you stay right in your seat. I'm going to, a moment, count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, bang. When you hear that sound, bang, your hand goes up all over this auditorium, and then you can stay in your seat. We're going to pray a prayer of faith to ask God to come into your heart and life and be born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. This couldn't get any simpler for you. All you have to do is admit. That's all you have to do is admit. I need God. And then we'll pray, you get born again, and then you can get filled with the Holy Spirit before this night is over. Tonight is your night of salvation. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? You know who you are. You live most of your life for yourself instead of God. I'm speaking to you. You've never given Him all of your heart, never given Him all of your life. I'm speaking to you. One of those people that are not sure, make sure. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're kind of lukewarm, the Bible says that in the book of Revelation, lukewarm is a little in, little out, little up, little down. You know, you're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Is that you? You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God? Can I say something? You're lukewarm. The Bible says in the book of Revelation, Jesus Himself is speaking. He says, I will vomit you from my mouth when I come. You don't want to miss Jesus and be vomited from His mouth because you're lukewarm. That's why you need to get strengthened in God, where the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And tonight is your night. All across this auditorium, if you're not right with God, right in your seat, we'll pray. The whole room will pray. But I need you to see your hand first. And what you're doing by raising your hand, you're saying, Pastor Jim, include me in on that prayer. I need that prayer. All across this auditorium, I'm going to count three, pop my hands together. You just put your hand up like this. I'll see it. And then you put it right back down. We'll pray together. And you're born again. And then we're going to pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit before you leave. Submersion of the Holy Spirit. All across this auditorium, if you're running from God, this is your time. If you're not sure, make sure. Today is your day. There's your hands already going up. Hold on, let me clap, and you get it up. You get your hand up at that time. Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Thank you. Back over here. 9, 10 up on top. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28. Thank you. There's 28. Thank you. There's 29, 30, 31. Thank you. 32 back over here. Thank you. God bless you. 32 in the family room. Is that where you're pointing out? 32. Oh, there's two more back there. 32, 33. Thank you. Anybody else, real quick? Okay, let's, anybody else? Because we're going to pray right now and you're going to miss it. 33, 34, thank you. Just say, include me in that prayer. 33, 34, 35, thank you. God bless you. Anybody else, real quick? 36, 37, that didn't get their hand already up. There's 37, where are you? There's a 37, 38. There's a 39, gotcha. Anybody else? Man, tonight you're getting it all. You're going to get salvation. 40, thank you. Tonight you're getting salvation. You're going to get the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You're going to fly out of this place tonight. You're going to be, you won't be a holy roller, but you're going to be a holy flyer. 41, 42, praise God. I'm only kidding. Well, maybe not. There's like 42 of you. Bow your heads. Everybody repeat this, including all of you that raised your hands. Say, Father God. No, everybody, say it out loud now. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son. I believe you sent Him for me. I believe He died for me. I believe His blood washes away my sins. I repent. I turn from my evil ways and I turn to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Tonight and forever, let it be known that I am born again. I am alive forevermore. I am a Christian. I'm going to heaven, and I'm denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Now fill me with your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Now give the Lord a great big praise. Come on. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.